My gosh, it's a big day for fans of treasure and or islands. Today we are reviewing an exceptional, unusual board game. It's Treasure Island.
Yes, based on the very classic property of Muppet's Treasure Island, I am thrilled to see that classic piece of literature finally getting its very own game. And oh, Mr. Bimble, am I excited about this? Also, I feel weird. I've eaten nothing but rum for about 3 weeks.
Yeah, that'll be the scurvy. Good news though, I've hidden an orange somewhere in this flat. Help me review this game and I'll give you 3 clues as to where it is. Now, hold on to your hats because this is exciting. One player in the game of Treasure Island is Long John Silver, who knows the location of the buried treasure and secretly marks it on their private map. However, Silver starts the game imprisoned, and for 17 days, meaning turns, he's going to be interrogated, leaking clues about where the treasure might be, like a sort of riddle-udder. The treasure is south of here. It's not within 5 miles of the volcano. It's between these 3 points. Until by the end of the game, the map looks like something you might recover from a conspiracy theorist's garbage. All of the other players in the game, 1 to 4 of them, are going to be spending their turn hiking around the island in search for the treasure, digging up whole acres of sand and soil using these circular tokens and asking over and over again, is the treasure here? And if it is, then they have won. Players will also spend their turn collecting private pirate clues from Long John Silver, taking private pirate notes behind their screen, none of which they want to share with the other pirates. But the game never descends into an ornate, irate pirate stalemate because on day 17, Long John Silver escapes from prison. And if he can get to the treasure first, then he wins.
And that is a high concept that when you're explaining how to play this game, is going to turn even the most curmudgeonly of frowns upside down into big old smiles. And that's not it. There's way more here that's cool. First of all, cool tools. These amazing little plastic things which you can put to help you make marks on the map. Rulers, discs, compasses, an actual wooden compass to draw circles on with your little pens. And then mini dinky tools that you use to draw clues on your mini dinky maps.
You got changed, you look good.
Yeah, I don't get invited to many fancy dress parties or find an excuse.
I'm gonna get changed also.
Are you gonna wear eyeliner as well?
No, that would be dumb, because you need Jack Sparrow. I've got it, just leave it to me.
Okay, I thought we could both wear eyeliner, it'd be like we're at a party. I miss parties.
Different players each also have special pirate powers, where Anne Bonnie can, once per game, send the monkey off to search anywhere, whilst savvy Charlotte de Berry has ancient scrolls telling her where the treasure definitely isn't.
What is it?
Can I teach my favourite role?
Yeah. Okay. So, of the 7 clues that Long John Silver gives players over the course of the game, 2 of them might not be true.
So they're lies.
No, they might be lies, or 2 of them might not be lies. That is my favourite noise in all of board gaming! So, on a pirate's turn, they can spend 1 of their actions to check the validity of the clue, secretly, so no one else knows what the answer is. But this is a horrible thing to do. You only get about 10 actions in the course of the entire game. Far better, then, to let one of the other pirates around the table check the validity of a clue and see what they do next.
And this is where we get to the fantastically odd group psychology that comes up to the surface when you're playing Treasure Island. It's a game not just of mathematical deduction and looking at circles and lines, but mathematical deduction and sheer cunning.
Yes!
Look at this absolute Burke behind me, for example. He just spent his entire turn checking the validity of something that Long John Silver had just said. Long John Silver said, the treasure is not in a forest. He spent the first half of his turn just checking to see if that was true. And then he spent the second half of his turn searching. And I looked at that and I realized that he basically searched an area which has a bit of forest in it. From that, I can deduce that when he checked the validity of that clue, it was a lie. Because otherwise, why would he have looked in a forest? definitely, probably can't be. And also, Long John Silver can only tell two lies for the whole game, and I'm pretty sure that the altitude thing here is a lie. So that's probably... So even on a turn that wasn't mine, just watching somebody else, an idiot like this guy, taking his turn, I've learned a huge amount about where the treasure is. Probably.
Treasure Island is so good at making everybody feel clever and excited for their first few turns, but as you stack supposition upon hypothesis, as you cover your personal map in notes, and the thickness of the nib feels incredibly inadequate for making accurate deductions.
This is a family show.
The science of this game slowly turns into a delicious, sand-blasted, dehydrated madness. You get to watch your friends go from, I believe that the treasure is most likely to be here, to, I'm going back and searching the forest again. Why are you doing that? Wouldn't you like to know? And part of that is because you're searching with circles, which are great for making Long John Silver feel tense that you're covering so much ground, but they are terrible for being methodical. And it means that even when you do a search, you always leave these bitter little slices between your searches that always sit in your mind like splinters, leaving you worried that even though you searched there, you might have missed it. And all of this comes together to create a game that entertains not just on the table with a puzzle that everyone's enjoying, but above the table as you're loving all of your friends' reactions to this experience.
For most of the game, players will greedily misdirect one another, hoarding what little they know to themselves in the hope of sending off the rest of your crewmates off on a wild goose chase around the island whilst you get the booty all to yourself.
And that's fun, but the game doesn't have to stay that way. Because as time creeps on and Long John Silver gets closer and closer to breaking out of jail and making fools of you all, players, in our experience, will often start sharing notes, start telling other players what their secret clues are, because individual players' desires to win is less than their desire to be made a fool out of. And this means the game undergoes this fascinating, one-of-a-kind transformation from a competitive game into, sometimes, a cooperative one.
And nobody is sitting back and enjoying the show more than Long John Silver. Honestly, playing as Long John is so unlike anything else we've ever experienced that if you're a board game collector, it might be worth buying Treasure Island just to give this a go. As you sit there, effectively prancing around in your velvet booties like some sort of horrible riddle master, giving out public clues, private clues, and just watching as people don't share everything with each other, and you drive everybody slowly mad, and they say, oh, is it here on the map? And you go, oh, let me just double check. Is it there? No, because it's not anywhere near there. It's all the way over here. But every turn, keeping them on their toes, writhing in horror. Here's a brilliant thing you can do. Try telling all the players to close their eyes because you need to check something on the map when you don't. Get me a parrot. I was made for this.
The other side of playing Long John Silver is concealing dread when one player with all of the brain power of one of those little wind-up monkeys with the little symbols starts actually getting close to your treasure when you've given them no reason to think it's there. And while those circles are so good at confounding players, they're going to feel preposterously large to you. And there's absolutely nothing you can do but pray that player moves on. Oh, it's so good.
Like 1990s Christian PC software, I like a game with an arc. And Treasure Island has one hell of an arc. After you've played the game the first time, you know that the best way to play is just to work together to beat Long John Silver. But the muscle that rows this wonderful boat is the selfish voice in the back of your brain. And that's the same voice that has people all over the world still wanting to play Monopoly. It's the idea that this time, maybe things will be different. This time, I'll be the one who gets all of the money. But unlike Monopoly, which doesn't give you the option to devolve the banking systems and redistribute property to fit the needs of the people, Treasure Island understands that there's nothing more important than not being beaten by the man.
But as we've said before, cooperation is only true cooperation if you have a choice, which you do in this game. And that's why it's so much more exciting. Mm. So the puzzle is good.
Yep.
It's lots of fun. Mm. It's a fascinating social experiment. We do have one criticism. And in the case of Treasure Island, it's about the usability. Mm. You may notice that some of the colored pens on this board don't show up very well, despite the fact we're using the reds and blacks. But
yeah, if we actually use the blues and the greens, which we haven't used whilst filming this review, because they just aren't really visible on the board at all. And this breaks my heart, because you know what? This board, as a piece of art, as a piece of colour, is alive and exciting and beautiful, and I adore it. But it doesn't really work very well for this game, because there's so much contrast and saturation. Just look at it compared to this standardised reference pair. The contrast is so high, whereas this is much lighter, and the pens just do not show up on the map. However, if they'd gone for an old-style sepia washed-out low-contrast map, then look at that. Beautiful. Visible. I am alive.
We can play on this bright coloured side of the board because we're under studio lighting, but for most of the time during our playtesting of Treasure Island, we just ended up using the sepia side.
Yep.
Which isn't great. We delayed the filming of this review so I could go out and buy loads of different pens to see if any of them are better for this game.
And it wasn't even once. Like, he kept going out into London again and again trying to find pens and being like, trying them and being like, no, this doesn't work, I'm going out again. Like, we were like feral eight-year-olds trying to collect felt-tip pens in a post-apocalyptic world where colouring in is the only thing that can keep us sane.
Yeah, that's, I mean, none of this.
And I mean, the only ones that, I mean, like, these cheapo whiteboard markers, which are the oil soon dry, the adhere is strong, and any art and smooth surface can, these kind of work a bit better.
This is the thing with Treasure Island. Everything about it does work. Kind of. Similarly, I'm sad to say that on my third or fourth play of the game, my compass broke. It's loose enough now that we can't use it. But again, this isn't a huge problem. I now use this piece of string. Matt, can you take a pen, please?
Yeah.
And then someone ties it around a pen. So when you need to draw circles, someone just does that
with a
like
thing.
A little co-op thing.
Yeah, this is fun. It's like I'm in a bank. I can't steal the pen. Oh, Mr. Bank Manager, can I have a loan?
Well, no, because the foundation of your business is donations, and that is impractical when it comes to assessing risk.
Oh, that got real. Matsuko usually put together really solid boxes, but the production of this one just feels like it was a little outside of their comfort zone. But it's a game that is very, very good, so that might not matter so much to you. But if you are somebody who really doesn't like the idea of having to go and source your own pens or maybe replace some of the components, that's completely fair.
I mean, for me, as someone who likes their games looking a bit well-loved and personalised, where's my string? This wasn't really a problem to me at all. I mean, this is such a one-of-a-kind game.
It's not a deal-breaker, but it may well be a deal-shaker.
That is not a thing. I would still, anyway, absolutely recommend this game. I'm keeping it, I'm loving it, I want to show it to people. How do you feel?
I think I do as well. I also think that the old scars in my body are reopening due to a vitamin C deficiency.
Man, that's gonna be the scurvy again.
I did the review with you. Can I have an orange?
Okay, I'll give you three clues. Clue number one.
I need an orange.
I had an orange. Clue number two. I ate the orange. Clue number three, you don't have scurvy. You just have a dangerously overactive imagination.
I live to say another day!
But imagine if you did have scurvy. It's a deeply serious condition that affects pirates of all ages. Thanks for watching today's video. And remember, scurvy costs untold risks. Veritably, yes.
No, even despite the thing with the pens and the board and the annoyance you had with the compass, it undoubtedly is a game that deserves the Shut Up and Sit Down Recommends badge.
Absolutely.
It is just a beautiful idea executed with love and flair, and crucially, as we often say, understands that beautiful components and things are nice, but the most important thing is the people around the table.
Yeah. Treasure Island is a game that reminds us you can have it all. You can have a fantastic puzzle that gets your brain going. You can have this beautiful art and storytelling that transports you to another world. But where all of this is in the service of making the players themselves, your friends and family, the stars of this particular show. And if you want more inspiration of games where you can have it all, why not? Let's just remove Matt. Let's cover him with other fabulous Shut Up and Sit Down videos.
I can't, Quinns, I can't breathe.
It's fine, just bear with it, bear with it.
I can't.
These are some other reviews we've done of games where we think just they offer everything that that money can buy. Basic, Matt, are you, Matt?
Oh,